I feel like you guys kind of went about the creation of this business different than most of Silicon Valley, so to speak, does. If I remember correctly, you guys didn't take venture capital, or at least not at the beginning. So can you chat a little bit more about how did you build a tech company from the ground up without that?
So one thing to know about venture capital is that it's very helpful if you are building something that can't be profitable for a while. So if you're doing something like flying cars, right, where you just have to invest a lot in building your product and you can't really put it out in market for a while, or like Uber at the beginning, where you're introducing a completely new way to do things and it's going to take a while for the market to really adopt that new way, then it's incredibly helpful because it can bring these new innovations, right, to life. But for us, we knew that we would be able to create something that pretty quickly could make money for our customers, right? So we knew that in turn, we could make a profitable business pretty much right away. So at that point, giving up a big chunk of the company for cash that we wouldn't need didn't feel right. It felt like that investment would be too expensive for us. And then we also realized that by taking that path, yes, I mean, it sounds glitzy and glamorous and exciting, but all of a sudden you start having a lot of people that you respond to. And the reason why it's been such a hit, it's because we listen to our members and that's it. And I'm not saying that we won't fundraise eventually, like maybe one day we want to build a really big conference and bring everyone together, and maybe for other different initiatives, or there's been a lot of, oh my God, so many ideas our members have that some of those will probably take investment, but for just the core product, it was not necessary.
That totally makes sense. And it's funny you bring up, you know, a company like Uber. I don't think they're still not profitable, actually, even after going public. So I totally understand like your thought process behind that. And I always believe that if you can bootstrap something, you should, especially because I think that something a mentor told me once that really resonated with me was they said, oftentimes when you just get an influx of cash and you don't know how to manage it, you start to use it as an excuse to solve problems instead of using your critical thinking or instead of using your people and your team to solve them. So I think that it's really smart that you guys decided to go a different way.
And in the end of the day, we're serving small business owners. And this is how they do it. They don't have VC firms backing them, right? So
right.
If y'all can build these, we can do it too. And I think that was a big core fuel for us.
I love that. Lead the way. That's amazing.
I think, Ellen, what you said about being scrappy and using your brain instead of your bank account is so spot on, because there were so many decisions that we had to make to get the product out in any kind of reasonable amount of time, because we have a very, very small team. We started with an even smaller team. And so that really forced us to do so much research when we were first building the product into what exactly people really did need and what they could live without. And it's kind of amazing how much a lot of software programs have built into them that are truly not needed and almost become confusing. And, you know, I call it feature bloat, but you don't need a ton of features. You just need the right features. And by not having tons of money to invest in the product up front, we chose those features very specifically and very intentionally. And I actually think that's one of the things that makes the product so special.
It took us about a year and a half to go to market. And we are still in private beta. So we still haven't launched. We built a private beta self-onboarding version of the product. And we did not expect the type of growth that we've been seeing. And I think something happens when you're day in, day out working on your product, and you see everything that like you know your vision, and you see what you currently have out there, and you see how much better it can be. And one thing we didn't realize is what we currently have is already so much better than anything that's out there. And we just didn't account for that. So we do not have a sales team. We do not have a marketing team. we have a member success team, and their role is to make sure that our members are successful using the platform. And the growth that we've been seeing is all word of mouth. Nothing that I'm going to say next will work if you're building a vitamin and not a painkiller. So make sure that you're building something that really solves a problem. If you want to build a big company, solve a big problem for a big market. And if you have that, then everything that I'm going to say will probably work. So the first thing that we did was super scrappy. I just went on Facebook forums and posted, hey, we're working on a new solution. Who wants to test it? And the goal was not customer acquisition. The goal was to get very honest, like brutal, heartbreaking feedback just to see what's working and what's not and get closer to what we really needed to build. Based on that, we got a very small core group of beta members. It was like 30 people that we weren't charging. And then, so one thing about building a startup is that there's a lot of free education out there about it. So we would always be like reading these things, taking courses, joining accelerators and anything that wouldn't cost us money. And we could just like absorb all the information. So one of the things that we heard was charge early, ask for money early, not because you want to make money, but just because you want to see if people are willing to pay for it. And that will give you a lot of intel into whether you've got a solution that could go to market or not. So then we came back to our beta members and we were like, okay, well, we're going to start asking for a monthly subscription now. And everyone was up for it. So then we started realizing, okay, whatever we have is getting really close to putting it out there. So then the next step was hashing out anything that we needed to do to increase conversion. So for example, we would drop new members into an empty my emails section. And that's not really exciting. It could also be confusing. So one core principle that we decided very early on was let's turn everything into a flow. So whenever you come into the software, you are already being handheld to produce the output that you want. So we made a small switch, like instead of dropping them into the My Emails area, we drop them into the template gallery. So now they're coming in and they're shopping for the brand and look and feel that they want for that email, and they're inspired, so they're more likely to send an email. So we made those tweaks. And then we created a landing page because we didn't even have a landing page. So Rebecca, do you want to share a little bit more about how?
Well, I actually wanted to add something here. I think this is really important for people, especially wanting to create a really ambitious product. And trust me, this Flodesk was a lot more ambitious than we even thought going in. I mean, we thought it would take 3 months to get an MVP and it took a year and a half. But our MVP was not a software that people could use. Our MVP was a software that could send email with a very primitive builder that I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy, but that I could get around. And I would
explain what is an MVP.
Oh yeah, good point. It's a minimum viable product. So basically, what is the most bare bones minimal item you can put out there that someone is willing to use or pay for? So in this case, it was actually this bare bones builder that I piloted and a system to send out some emails. And we would, those 30 beta testers, I actually designed custom emails for each one. I did it in Photoshop and then put it into our builder. And from there, we went to our engineering team and said, hey, how can we actually reproduce this process so that people can edit these designs on their own without Photoshop? And so that was another process. But we started from there, and then as Martha said, we started making tweaks to the onboarding, we started adding a few more features, and then we ended up pushing that live, although you couldn't really access it unless you had the URL because it wasn't posted anywhere. But then I remember we did the landing page, and then a few days later, I remember one of our she's our community advisor, but also a really good friend of ours, Natalie Frank, was one of our first testers of the system as it exists today. And I remember she was coming into it fresh because she had just been on maternity leave. So she hadn't been testing the software out before and hadn't really seen the iterations. And she'd been using, she was a diehard ConvertKit user. And I remember she called me up and she's like, Rebecca, this is incredible. I'm so excited. And she showed me the email that she built in the builder. And it was just light years beyond anything I'd seen people create in the industry without a design team. And she had a rather large list, and we didn't even ask her. She just, on her own, put a little, loving this email at the bottom, check out Flodesk. That's how I made it. And I remember at that point in time, we were maybe getting 1 to 2 people starting a trial a day just because we had posted here and there on Facebook groups. And it was just like word was leaking out slightly into the ether. But she hit send on that email. And I remember we woke up that morning and the engineering team was freaking out. We were freaking out because we started seeing this stream of people starting a trial, and it went from a couple a day to 50 an hour. And
wow,
it was just, it was an explosion. And I would say in the creation of the universe, it all started with the Big Bang. And I would say that email was the Big Bang of Flodesk. And it's been like that ever since. It was just incredible.